peace with my Maker since he brought me here today. I'm at peace with the Lord who has washed my sins away. I'm at peace with my Savior, for he filled my heart with joy. I'm at peace with the Lord today. From the top, come let us worship the Lord all together here today. Let us worship the Lord in his presence as we pray. He'll be there to receive you, and his presence you'll enjoy. Be at peace with the Lord today. I am at peace with my Maker since he brought me here today. I'm at peace with the Lord who has washed my sins away. I'm at peace with my Savior, Lord, he has filled my heart with joy. I'm at peace with the Lord today.
Give the Lord a great big hand clap. Give him a great big hand clap. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We love you, Lord. We give you glory, Lord. Hallelujah. Bless your name. Hallelujah. We bless your name, oh God. Oh, we lift you up today. Hallelujah. Pastor Charlie, will you open us in prayer, please?
Hallelujah. Our God of grace, we come before you today, Lord Jesus, to give you the honor, the praise, and the glory. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for your guardian angels, Lord, that watches over us day and night, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for your loving hand touch, Lord, of wickedness clothed and have a right mind. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for life, health, and strength, Lord Jesus, the activity of our lives, Lord. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for taking us and bringing us, Lord, over the dangerous highways and byways, Lord, back to the house of praise to give you the honor and the glory. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus, we thank you, Lord. From Victory Tabernacle, praise and worship center where there is love, Lord. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for our pastor, Pastor Timothy Hinkle, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for your disciples, Lord Jesus, that are present right now, Lord Jesus, to give you the praise, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus, we come to magnify your name, Lord. We come to hold up the bloodstained banner, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord, we ask you, Lord Jesus, look upon the heads of the countries everywhere, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord, we ask you, Lord, look upon our president, Lord, in the name of Lord. Look upon his heart and soul and his mind, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus, we ask you, Lord Jesus, rain down your Lord, rain, Lord Jesus, upon the White House, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Rain down, Lord Jesus, the Lord, rain, Lord, upon, Lord Jesus, the Democrats and the Republicans, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus, you are in charge, Lord. Have your way, Lord, let your will be done, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord, we ask you, Lord, look upon every sanctuary, Lord, throughout the nation, Lord. In the name of Jesus, Lord God of hosts, Lord, look upon every apostle, Lord Jesus, every apostle, Lord, Lord God of hosts, Lord, every evangelist, Lord, every preacher, Lord, in the name of Jesus, Lord God of hosts, Lord, we ask you, Lord Jesus, to look upon, Lord, the sick and the shut in everywhere, Lord, in the name of Jesus, touch their bodies, Lord, with your healing power, Lord, from on high, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord, we ask you, Lord Jesus, look upon one of our mothers, Lord. Oh God, that had a stroke, Lord Jesus, we ask you, Lord, to touch her body, Lord, from the crown of her head, Lord, to the sole of her feet, Lord, with your healing virtue, Lord. You are the doctor of all doctors, Lord, healer of all healers, Lord, surgeon of all surgeons, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord, we ask you, Lord Jesus, touch and anoint the speaker and the teacher, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Look upon the musicians, Lord, the choir, Lord Jesus, and the praise team, combined together, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord, we thank you right now, Lord. Lord God of hosts, Lord, look upon the backsliders everywhere, Lord. Those, Lord Jesus, that are confined to nursing homes, convalescing homes, hospitals in their homes, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord, look upon the hungry, the starving, the homeless everywhere, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Drug addicts and prostitutes, Lord, alcoholics, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Homosexuals, male and females, Lord, look upon their hearts, their souls, and their mind, Lord. Give them to know, Lord, that you still live, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord, we thank you right now, Lord, for your anointing, Lord. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your presence, Lord. Lord God of hosts, Lord, look upon those behind prison bars, Lord, juvenile halls, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord, we ask you, Lord, rain down your Holy Ghost, Lord, upon the service today, Lord. Rain it down, Lord. Rain down your body, rain also, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We thank you right now, Lord, for your presence, Lord. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for being our keeper, being our guide. Lord God of hosts, Lord, we ask you, Lord, take charge and have your way, Lord. These blessings and others, we ask in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You know, we have a program.
Thank you.
We're going to go straight into worship. We're going to come back to the announcements later. We are going to have the Lord's Supper, although it's not in the program today.
Just like you, Lord, in all the earth. Matchless making knees in all the earth.
To worship you, I live to worship you. you. From our humble hearts, God Almighty, we honor you. We prioritize you this morning, for you are glorified. You deserve your glory. Forgive us, Almighty Father, for our worship is so not enough. So not enough to crown you, to honor you this morning. From the deepest of our souls, God Almighty, please honor and accept our praise this morning. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Hallelujah. Thank you for your heart of obedience. He is honored, he is glorified, amen. Why we honor him? Because every time we call upon him, he is always there for us, amen. Words of the song says, Jesus is on the main line. Tell him what you want, amen. Jesus on the main line, get you found me. Tell him what you want.
Set me free. I'm so glad. Jesus set me free.
I'm sorry, Maria. I can't keep my kisses all over it. Thank you. Okay. We need to be in His presence, amen. You know, it's good to shout and have fun in the church and praise God. 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 So we kind of opened up with the worship. We kind of did it a little bit inverted today, yeah. But that's okay, you know. Because His presence is so important, amen. Amen. That's where we come together.
Hallelujah.
We come together to worship Him, amen.
Yes, Lord.
Let's just sing from our hearts. Oh, we love you, Lord. Oh, just play something random. Whatever you play, brother John. Praise the Lord. We'll just sing along. I want to just pause for a minute in His presence, because too often we just rush.
Yes, Lord.
Out of worship or out of praise. So we just rush to the next thing, the next bullet point of the program. But I just want to honor Him today, amen.
And when time surrenders
no more. I still cling to the old rugged
clergy to come now. And as we continue to sing or play the music, we're going to ask you to come forward and receive the emblems. We'll partake of the Lord's Supper together.
Had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary.
Said, take, eat. This is my body. Do all remember it took me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. I'd like to explain the reason we proclaim his death. We rejoice in his resurrection on Resurrection Sunday, but we proclaim his death every time we receive the Lord's Supper, because it's his death that paid the sacrifice for you and me. It's his death where he took our place, and he took the sins upon him.
It's the reason that we don't have to stone our children when they sass us or kill people when they break the law. Because the wages of sin is death. But Jesus took the penalty of sin upon himself. And all we must do is freely accept the gift of salvation and repent of our sins. Amen. We're commanded, therefore, whoever eats of this bread or drinks of this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. There are two things here that we don't do. We don't treat the Lord's Supper as common. Amen. We don't treat it as though just a cracker and some grape juice.
Amen.
Because it's set apart, it's sanctified, it's holy, it's dedicated unto the Lord.
Amen.
Therefore, it's sanctified.
Yes, Lord.
The other thing that we do not do is we do not partake of the Lord's cup when we are actively engaged in sin that we are not repentant of. It's not to say that we don't all have struggles, we don't all fall, but we want to make sure that we are asking the Lord to forgive us and wash us clean by the blood of Jesus for every one of our shortcomings, and then to empower us by His Holy Spirit to walk according to His precepts. Amen?
Amen.
So let us pray, each one of us individually. Examine your heart. Ask the Holy Spirit to examine your heart and to show you anything that's not pleasing to the Lord so that we may confess it to Him. He is faithful to separate our sin from us as far as the east is from the west.
Amen.
And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Jesus was a Jew. He would have said the Hamotzi. He would have said, Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam hamotzi lechem min haaretz. And let's say the English together. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings forth the bread from the earth, thus prophesying of his own resurrection. Let's partake of the bread.
Amen.
In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. He would have said the blessing over the wine, which Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech haolam b'rei pirei chagafen. Say the English together. Blessed are you, Lord, our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine, thus proclaiming that by washing away our sins, He's grafted us into the true vine, and we are the fruit of the vine. Let's drink the Lord above. And so then they sing a hymn. Let's sing a hymn. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus.
Thank you.
My life is not my own. To you I belong.
you, Jesus. Thank you, Heavenly Father.
Amen. 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 Am
Sister Barbara, if you'll come now.
Good morning. Good morning. Hasn't service been so wonderful so far? Oh my goodness, God is so good. Well, you know what I'm here for. You know, the Lord has a request on me though. You pay your tithing first, because it's a commandment. And second, because it's a blessing. And you know, someone came up to me this morning, well, Deb came up to me this morning, and the Lord has been just impressed on her to tell me that you have not because you ask not. Have you ever thought of that before? You know, you think God knows. He knows my heart. He knows how what I'm thinking. And He does. But He wants to hear how much you love Him. And He wants you to show Him how much you love Him by paying your tithes and your offerings. And because it is a commandment, God is faithful to those. I didn't hear what you said, Bobby Joe, but that's right. Just look what I'm sure most of you know, but you know, the Lord, you know, even if you don't have anything else, you're not going to go hungry in this church. Because God blesses us. He gave us an abundance of food this week. So that not only could we be blessed, but we could bless others. You know, God can pour in people. You know, sometimes, you know, you've heard people say, the way to a man's heart is through his stomach. Well, you know, sometimes Jesus uses that. The way to receive Him is through reaching out to them. And then they know how much God really, really cares about us. He is so faithful to us people. We do have needs, and you know, this is the first of the month, so all your bills are due. And you know what? That's no different in our house, in the Lord's house. So let's stand this morning. Just remember, God is faithful to the giver. And that's not just in your money. You know, you might say today, oh, you know, I don't feel like giving it today, I'll give it next week. But you know what might happen this week? Your car might break down. And He might use that money. Because you're not faithful to Him. And you know your car may break down anyway. But you know what? God will provide. He always provides for us. But when we give to Him first, our first fruits, He multiplies. I don't know sometimes where how the money just gets stretched so far. I don't know how all these extras that I can do, but God honors. I just can't say it enough. God honors the faithful ones. Lord Jesus, we know that we have not because we ask not. And Lord, we know that You are faithful to the faithful. You are faithful to the faithful. And that You honor what is given. Lord, we just thank You so much for the opportunity. Because sometimes people don't take the opportunity to give and to show You how much they love You. Father, we love You. We honor You. And we ask that You would just receive what we have to give. In Your precious name, we give You all the thanks. Amen. In Jesus' name, amen.
Ahuna Yesu, Ahuna Yesu, Ahuna Yesu. Front of your school, junior high school, and we will give you little orange testaments. They are printed by the Gideons. But the thing is, those same little testaments are printed in 90 other languages all over the world. A lot of people just think of the Gideon Bible in the hotels. Okay? Those Bibles in hotels have saved thousands upon thousands of people, and we have testimonies in our national and international conventions, which are too expensive for me to go to. We have a lot of Gideons that are wealthy, and they put a lot of money. None of the money that people give us goes into our pockets. It goes into printing Bibles. Can you imagine a million Bibles given out around the world in 3 days? Every 3 days. That's why we work. We're warriors for Christ. We carry a little brown Gideon personal testament. We find people on the street. Many times, those people on the street, we check them out and we say, okay, we put a dollar or two inside that Bible, and then we hand it to them. But we ask them to read the instruction, shall I say, the story about the Gideons on the second page in that Bible. Then we take them to the back page. It walks you through giving your heart to Jesus. We ask you to sign it. And hallelujah, we have testaments that come back to us from all over the world. Of all of those people who have given their lives, changed their lives. And we have testimonies galore that come out every year. A full book, a little paper pamphlet, but with testimony after testimony of those things that touch people's hearts.
Praise God. Hallelujah.
And that's all I'm going to give you today.
Yes.
And if my old voice can come up with a song that I can still sing, maybe.
All right.
Thank you, Pastor Tim.
A million Bibles every 3 days. That's quite a bit, right?
Yes.
A million Bibles every 3 days. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. I have Sister Gloria come now, all the way from Montana, and she's going to minister a special song before the Parsha. We'll have a Parsha, and Brother Ray's going to come and minister a song. And I have a short message for you today, believe it or not. She's like, I can talk, amen. What a friend we have in Jesus. Right? You get it? All right.
I know I sang this song the last time I was here, but
all right.
I don't know how many of you remember when you were lost.
All right.
Oh, yeah.
But you were lost from him.
Right.
He knew where you were. And how many times that he's been our bread for our soul and our water when we're thirsty. And that's the song I'm going to sing again, Calvary's the Reason Why.
It's all right.
And just listen to the words. Don't listen to my voice because I'm kind of raspy this morning. You were bread for my soul. thank you, Lord. Without asking you for anything, but sometimes I lift my hands to you. Thank you, Jesus. Sometimes all I do is cry. Everything that I have, I owe to you. And Calvary's the reason why. When I think of the love that you've given me, Lord, and when I think of the price you paid for me, thank you, Jesus. Then all the trials of this earth, they seem like nothing. When they're compared to dark Calvary, sometimes I just want to praise you. Thank you, Jesus. Sometimes just to speak your name. Sometimes I just want to thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Without asking you for anything, sometimes I lift my hands to you. Thank you, Jesus. Sometimes all I do is cry. Everything that I have, I owe to you. And Calvary's the reason why. You should know by now. Sometimes I just want to praise you. You can sing it with me. Sometimes just to speak your name, Jesus. Sometimes I just want to thank you. And sometimes I lift my hands to you. Thank you, Jesus. Sometimes all I do is cry. Everything that I have, I owe to you.
Unless she appears here in a moment. She's taking care of another duty. So, as you know, we go through the Parsha once a year. It's an incredible tool to minister to the Jewish community, but it's also a good practice to read through the instructions annually. Amen?
That's what the Torah is. Better interpretation for the law is instructions. And this week's portion is called When He Sent. Amen. Beshalach, When He Sent, for the week of February 5th through the 11th. The Torah portion readings are Exodus 13, 17 through Exodus 17, 16. Judges 4, 4 through Judges 5, 31. And then the Bereshit, the New Gospel, Matthew 5, the whole chapter. So now here's Pastor Fonda to give you the summary.
God. Messianic and Davidic dance. Thought for the week. How did the Israelites have tambourines in the desert? The righteous women of that generation were certain that God would perform miracles for them, so they prepared tambourines and dances while still in Egypt. Rashi and Machilta on Exodus 15:20. Miriam, the prophetess, Aaron's sister, took the timbrel in her hand, and all the women went out after her with timbrels and with dancing, Exodus 15:20. Singing songs of praise and worship is popular in one form or another in virtually every type of Christianity or Judaism. Messianic Judaism has developed a unique worship expression called Davidic dance. In all but the most orthodox of Messianic Jewish congregations, it is common to find worshipers joining together in dance circles while the rest of the congregation sings. The dances are sometimes elaborately choreographed. Sometimes they're simple Israeli folk dances. Messianic dance might be a bit surprising for newcomers to a Messianic synagogue. In many religious backgrounds, dancing is banned, along with the cardinal sins of drinking, smoking, and gambling. People come from similar religious places might be perplexed to come into a house of worship and find people engaged in dance. Messianic dance has its roots in the song at the sea. After Moses and the sons of Israel had finished singing the great hymn of Exodus 15, Moses' older sister Miriam took a timbrel in her hand and led the women in song and dance. Biblical dance was an expression of celebration. For example, when King David victoriously returned from battle with the Philistines, the women of Israel came out singing and dancing to meet him. When King David brought the Ark of the Covenant in Jerusalem, he danced before it all the way into the city. The prophet Jeremiah tells us that when the Messiah comes, there will be dancing. Then the virgin will rejoice in the dance, and the young men and the old together, Jeremiah 31:13. Dance was a natural expression of joy and worship in ancient Israel. The psalmist enjoins the worshipers in the temple to praise the Lord with dancing. Let them praise his name with dancing. Let them sing praises to him with timbrel and lyre. Praise him with the timbrel and dancing. Praise him with the stringed instruments and pipe. Psalms 149:3, 150:4. In Judaism, dance has always been a popular way of celebrating and expressing joy. In some sects of Judaism, holy men dance with ecstasy in the presence of God. However, in non-Messianic Judaism, dance in a synagogue service is unusual. It ordinarily only happens at special occasions like Shemot Torah. Sorry. Messianic Judaism has combined dance with contemporary worship, contemporary worship music, and made it a staple of the regular Messianic worship experience. It looks like Messianic Jewish dance is here to stay. That case being the case, we should note that only the women danced at the Red Sea. Why didn't the men dance? Every time the Bible mentions dance, it is gender separated.
In biblical dance, men and women did not dance together. The only time men and women were separated in the temple was during the dancing that accomplished the feast of, that accompanied the Feast of Tabernacles. Since Messianic Judaism has fallen in love with Jewish dance, perhaps we should maintain its biblical integrity by keeping its gender separated. You know, it reminded me of when we come into the call and we went into a synagogue to worship with them, and they were dancing, the worship leaders were dancing and singing, and they came up to them, they said, where did that music come from? And they said, we got it from you. And they said, well, we want it back. And it's like, I think when I was reading that, I was thinking about that. Praise God.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, Mom. And we would like to have Brother Ray come at this time. He's prepared a special today. Hallelujah. Dear Heavenly Father, we just come to you now. We thank you.
We give you all the praise and we give you all the glory. Your word says several times, now let them that have an ear to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. So, Father, I pray for this, your people, the flock you put into my hand, and the guests that are here today as well. And I ask that you open their ears to hear. Let the same anointing that's upon me as I speak be upon them as they receive your holy word. Lord, let me decrease as you increase. And I give you all the praise. I give you all the glory. I thank you. You're the matchless Heavenly Father, and you're the matchless Savior. The name above all names, hallelujah. And there's nothing like your Holy Spirit. So we thank you so much for who you are, and we give you the praise. We ask these things in the name of Yeshua, HaMashiach. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen, amen, amen. Well, as I was preparing this about 3 weeks ago, the Lord dropped this sermon into my spirit. And I call this God's Fantastic Failures. And I abbreviated this message just a little bit today, because I have many more examples to go into. But I just picked out three or four that I thought that we could all relate to a little bit, amen?
Right.
And I was having a hard time coming up with a title for this sermon, so this isn't quite the title I would have liked, but I was thinking about it. We are each God's creation, amen?
Amen.
And we are born again through Christ Jesus, amen?
Yeah.
And that means that we're either what? Just like Big Hands Anderson used to say, I've never been down. I've been serving the Lord almost 50 years. He says, I've never been down. I've either been up or getting up, amen? I've been up or getting up, amen? And I want you to get a hold of that concept today. And I'm going to trouble this mic. Maybe give me some lows. There we go. So, as we look into Scripture, it is glaringly evident the need for mankind to have redemption. The need for redemption is in the very first book of the Bible. We don't get very far before mankind is in trouble. Amen? So let's look at the original failure of mankind. And we go to Genesis chapter 3, Adam and Eve, amen? Oh, there you see a typical portrayal of them with the forbidden fruit and Adam and Eve looking at this and the snake beguiling Eve to partake of that thing, that the only thing that our Heavenly Father and his matchless wisdom and knowledge and grace and love for mankind told them they could not eat of in the garden or partake of in the Garden of Eden. And of course, that is the one thing the enemy comes and beguiles them with. Do you have something like that in your life?
Right.
Are there things in your life that you're so grateful for because God has blessed you in so many areas, but there's this one little thing that you know you're not supposed to do, but it's the one thing you think about all the time. It's the one thing that you want to do all the time. Whenever your mind isn't focused on the Lord, you're thinking about that one thing that is not profitable for your soul.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
Let's look at this. Genesis chapter 3. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the women saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat.
All right.
Uh-oh, let's say it together. Uh-oh.
And thus, sin entered the world through mankind. Amen? Well, sin had been in the world because the serpent, Satan, was in the world. But sin entered mankind for the first time when they disobeyed God. Amen? But I just, is there something, I want you to think about this. Is there something in your life that you know that you know? I'm not talking about religious dogma. I'm not talking about, you know, being holier than thou or keeping appearances up. I'm not talking about doctrine. I'm talking about your relationship with God Almighty. Is there something he has told you is forbidden fruit for you, but yet, time and time again, you try to go back to it, and you try to justify it, amen? And you even use scripture sometimes. You'll say, oh, all things are lawful. You forget the second half, but all things are not profitable, you know? You've got to come in the fullness of the volume of the book like Jesus did. You've got to understand that you can't take part of that scripture out of context and twist it around to do what you want to do. It's like the, those that say, oh, no, no, you're not supposed to be the woman that was caught in the act of adultery. Have you heard that before? Well, first of all, it was a little sexist. I don't understand. The woman was caught in the act of adultery. I don't know. Where was the man? Where did he go? But I'm sure he was caught as well. But they were only going to condemn the woman.
That's right.
And Jesus, he saw the inequity to this, and he noticed that perhaps some of the people in the crowd that were accusing her were not so innocent of sin themselves, right? So what did he do? He got down, he wrote some things in the sand. I just love this. Because we can speculate all we want, but we will never know until we get to glory what he was writing. I think he was probably writing the name of other damsels that these men had been with. Themselves, other than their wives. And as they saw the name of their mistress on the sand, they walked away. Maybe. Maybe he was just writing the Torah.
All right now.
Who knows? God knows.
Amen.
The men that were there, they know. But I love how God gives people time to repent of their sins.
Hallelujah.
To this day, what he wrote in the sand is between the men that were standing there and the Heavenly Father.
Right.
But he walked away. But so many people in the world that want to do wrong, or even in the church, they'll say, oh, but Jesus said, judge not, neither do I condemn thee. And they stop. They stop.
Right.
But the next part of that verse is, go and sin no more.
Amen.
Neither do I condemn thee. You messed up. Now get up, go away, and don't do it again. Amen? That was the instruction. Now, we know sometimes it's hard to follow the instructions, but I wanted to show you what God, he sets up. He sets up the principle next. Let's look. And the Lord called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, who told you that I was naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree thereof, whereof I commanded thee that thou should not eat? I haven't preached on New King James in a while, can you tell? Hallelujah. But God said, he knew what they had done. God knows all things. God knows what we do. He knows all things. But he gives us an opportunity. Don't you understand the reason he created Adam and Eve in the first place was he wanted to have relationship with them. He wanted them to choose to do right. Do you ever feel that way with those of you that are parents? Do you ever just want to, you just want to give your child the opportunity to do the right thing because they have been taught and know the right thing? You don't want to always lord over and say, you got to do this, you got to be right. You want them to do the right thing because they know what the right thing is and they want to do the right thing. Amen? Our Heavenly Father is no different. So he goes through the garden and says, where were you? Where are you? But you know, oh boy. And the man said, the woman whom thou gavest, it's her fault. It's her fault. Isn't that what we always do? Parents, how many times have parents come to meet you in this church while their children were in high school and they've gotten into trouble and they're running with the wrong crowd and they get into worldly things, maybe they get into drugs or alcohol and they get caught. And the parents, they always come to me and they say, I mean, 99 times out of 100, it's not their child's fault. It's that bad kid over there that they were running around with. It's their fault. They influenced their kid. Well, we're each responsible for our own actions. But we always want to blame somebody else, you know? We always want to blame somebody else, you know? I know when I was running amok and I was living in sin, I made that choice because I wanted to sin. I did. I wanted to sin. I was raised in the church. I knew right from wrong. But I wanted to taste the fruit of sin. That's just the truth. You can blame it on this person or that person, but I wanted to know for myself. I paid a price for that. I still pay a price today, and we won't go into that. There are consequences, but hallelujah, more than anything, there's forgiveness in Christ Jesus. And he'll take your crooked places and he'll make them straight, amen? He'll make them straight. And the Lord God said unto the woman, what is that that thou hast done? And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me, and I did eat. The Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon their belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. But here's a prophecy. He hasn't even finished meeting out the punishment yet, and he gives the redemption plan. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, and it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. If you go a little bit deeper and you do some word studies, you'll find out he was talking about Christ coming through the seed of the woman. They would come as a man and redeem mankind. They would only bruise Christ's heel by putting him on the cross, but because he rose again, he crushed the serpent's head. Right. Better interpretation. Crushed his head. You saw it in the, you saw it portrayed in the last temptation of Christ, where Jesus is in the garden praying, and he crushes the head of Satan as a prophecy of what he was going to do on Calvary's cross. He put an end to sin and brought forgiveness for all of us. Hallelujah. Well, Adam and Eve, they were driven out of the garden, and God put an angel there with a flaming sword to keep them from re-entering. But guess what they did? They just went on. They went on with life. And they had children. And they had Cain and they had Abel. And they still had a promise from God. He was going to send the Messiah through their lineage. Amen? In fact, Eve is known as the mother of all living. And they just went on. Sometimes after we sin, we have to pin up and we just have to go on, no matter what the price is. No matter what the consequence is, we just have to push forward, knowing that God will be with us if we call upon him. Amen? And then we see what happens with their sons. And Adam and Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel, and Abel was the keeper of the sheep, and Cain was the tiller of the ground. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. And Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock and of the fat thereof. And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering, but unto Cain and to his offering he had no respect. And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. And the Lord said unto Cain, now listen what God says to Cain. If he would have just listened to this, everything would have been different. Why art thou wroth? And why hast thou countenance fallen? If thou doest well, shalt thou not be accepted? See what God said? Why are you so upset? I didn't accept your sacrifice. I told you what to do. Just go do what's right. Don't accept your sacrifice. But instead of choosing to do the right thing, he got angry. And he got angry with his brother, and he went and he killed him. Do you know
if he would have just repented and done what God told him to do, his offering would have been accepted.
Yeah.
He could have traded the fruit for some of his brother's cattle. He could have made a sacrifice. Because without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. The whole reason for the sacrifice was a symbol or a promise of Christ to come. Amen? And the blood of the Lamb was going to take the place of our blood on the cross. And Cain didn't understand this, but instead of getting to know God more, instead of pushing into his presence, he just got angry because he didn't get his way. How many of us do that? We just get angry because we don't get our way. If God would just talk to me, then I would serve him. You see, you get angry. You see? If God would just give me this, then I could serve him. Angry. If God would just heal me, then I could angry. It's impossible to please God without getting to know his nature and understanding that he always does what is best for us. Always.
Amen.
As Sister Emily Yost continued to keep her in prayer, but as she thought she was dying before the Lord raised her out of her sickbed, she thought she was saying goodbye to her sons. What was so precious to me was that she said to the first one, she said, "Don't be mad at God if he takes me home. God is faithful. He's faithful, and he has a plan for your life." And she said to her second son, "I know you're going to miss me." Because he would say, "Don't go, Mama, don't go." And she says, "I know you're going to miss me, but you're strong. You're strong in the Lord. He's going to be with you, and he'll never forsake you. He'll never leave you. Even though we'll be gone, God will never leave you." What a testimony. She could be laying there like so many, "Well, I got my leg cut off, and I've been serving God all these years, and he's not healing me, and I'm going to die," you know? So many Christians act this way. God's ways are higher than our ways. As far as the heavens are above the earth, so far are God's ways higher than ours. We have to trust God that he has our best at heart all the time.
Amen.
Say all the time.
All the time.
You know, the healing was usually a sign. Yeah, healing is the children's bread. But healing was generally used as a sign for the unbeliever to bring them to Christ during Jesus' day. And, you know, those that are in Christ, what did Paul say? To be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord is a great gain. Amen?
Amen.
But if God has work and he's going to heal you, we continue on. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Let's go to the next slide. Let's look at Jonah. Another man that supposedly failed God. Amen? He was a prophet. And God said, "Now, I want you to get on our ship and go to Nineveh and tell them that they better repent or I'm going to destroy their city." Now, the Ninevites, they were wicked people.
Right.
You think ISIS is wicked? These people were worse than ISIS.
Right,
they used to make their lampshades out of the skin of their enemy. That's gruesome, right? After they would kill their enemies on the battlefield, they were cannibals. They would eat them, and they would take their skin and stretch them out and make lampshades and coats and everything else out of them. These were wicked pagan people. Wicked! And God told Jonah, "You get on a boat, you go to Nineveh, and you tell them that I am going to smite them if they don't repent." Jonah says, "I'm not going to Nineveh. I'm not going there, Lord. I'm not doing it." So he gets on a ship going the wrong way, the opposite direction.
Right?
He's not obeying God very well, is he? So he gets on a ship going the opposite direction. And the seas get warm. Well, all the people in the ancient world, they were very superstitious. They had all these false gods and all these things. Well, that came from basically Cain. His descendants, Nimrod and all of them, they intermarried with the Nephilim and all this garbage we won't get into today. But they had all these pagan gods they worshipped, you know. All the people were superstitious. And so they said, "Oh, the gods, whose God is angry with them? Someone on this ship, we're going to see it." And so they drew lots, and God made Jonah pull the short straw.
All right.
And he said, "It's me.
It's me. God told me to go to Nineveh, so I'm going here instead. And they said, oh, wow, why did you do this to us? He said, I don't know. Throw me overboard. So they threw him overboard, and they calmed down. And this big old fish that God had prepared gobbled him up. It wasn't a normal fish. It wasn't a whale. We call it Jonah the whale because whales are big. But whales are not fish. They're mammals. This was a giant fish that God had created just for this. And it swallowed Jonah up, and he was in the belly of that big, yucky fish with seaweed wrapped around his head, and the guts and intestines, all the stuff from inside of the fish were washing all over him. Who knows? He felt like he was in hell. You know, that's what the scripture says. Yes, then Jonah prayed unto the Lord his God out of the fish's belly. Right. That's pretty smart, right? Yeah. Hey, I got gobbled up by this giant sea monster, and I'm still alive. I better pray. I better ask God to deliver me. I better do something, because I'm either going to go meet him or I'm not going to go meet him, and that's worse. So he called out to God.
Yes.
Call out to God.
Yes.
When you're in the midst of your trouble, call out to God.
Yes.
Don't be so stubborn.
Amen.
He loves you.
He does.
Yes, he does. He doesn't want to see you destroyed. Call out to God.
Yes.
Jonah's situation looked horrible.
All right.
But see, God knows our hearts of men, right? He knew Jonah was going to cry out to him if he got swallowed up by a big fish. So he let him get swallowed up by a big fish. And Jonah cried. That's what it took for Jonah to cry out to him. And so the fish goes up to Nineveh and spits him out onto the beach. Now, here's the part of the story that you didn't know. The Ninevites, their god was a sea monster.
Right,
a giant fish god they had never seen, they'd only heard about.
Yeah.
So, here Jonah comes. Can you imagine the lookouts, the evil, wicked people of Nineveh looking out of the ocean, and they see this monster fish come out, and they think, hey, that looks like the god we worship. That looks like our statues. Oh my goodness! And then this fish vomits up a man. There's a seaweed all over him and everything. It looks like he's just created by this sea god.
All right.
And he goes up and they just open the gates of the city. They let him walk right in, and he goes and declares to the king, repent.
Yeah. All right now.
They repented.
All right.
Then he got angry. He wanted to see him destroyed. But they repented. Finally, he repented of wanting to see him destroyed. And he is known today as a success. Now, hallelujah. Go ahead. We're not going to read it. The last one I'm going to tell you about is Moses. Moses, what do you mean a failure? Yeah, he was a failure. Why? Because, well, he's not the last one I'm going to tell you, I got one more. God told him to speak to the rock in the desert. And because he got wet, what did Cain get?
Angry.
Because Moses got angry, instead of obeying God, he took matters into his own hands, and he did what? He struck the rock. Well, who was that rock that was giving them water? It's Jesus. Jesus, he's the rock, the sure foundation. He was the rock that showed up in the world. They passed that same spot many times. It was Jesus giving the living the water of life. You know, there is a physical manifestation for everything spiritual. And Jesus was giving them a physical water of life as an example that he gives the everlasting water. Are you okay with this?
Yes.
Hallelujah.
It just got to get moving.
God would not let him enter the promised land. But then again, look what happened to Mark 9:2-4. After 6 days, Jesus taketh with him Peter and James and John, and leadeth them up unto a high mountain, apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his raiment became shining exceedingly white as snow, so as no fuller on earth can white them. And there appeared unto them Elias with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. Even though Moses had disobeyed God, God loved him. We read about that love in the book of Jude. And we see that God even sent the archangel Michael for the body of Moses after he died. And it says, and then we're also given a very good example about dealing with sinful things. And it says, and neither did the archangel Michael bring a railing accusation against Satan when arguing over the body of Moses with him, but rather said, the Lord rebuke you, Satan.
All right.
You see, if you're in Christ Jesus, you come in the authority of Christ Jesus. Michael has came in the authority of Christ Jesus. He knew that Satan was a defeated foe because Jesus exists outside of time. Jesus paid the price on Calvary's Hill. Jesus had already defeated death upon the grave because he knew all things.
All right.
And Michael knew Satan's time was up and that Jesus was going to defeat him.
Yes.
I'm lost, Pastor. Well, think of this. How could Jesus on the cross of Calvary over 2,000 years ago take your sins upon himself? He exists outside of time as we understand it. Who did he say he was in the desert when he appeared to Moses? He said, I am that I am, right? And then we praise to God, the God that was and is and is to come. Jesus exists. He is always in every time. Jesus is omnipresent, not only all in physical time and space, but he is also omnipresent in time. Linear, the rules of linear time do not appear to him. So therefore, Michael knew Christ was the Redeemer of mankind, and he didn't even enter into the struggle. He said, wait, I'm not going to do this. The Lord rebuke you. You're defeated. Do you know when you're in Christ Jesus, you can say the Lord rebuke you, Satan?
All right.
And he has to go away. You just have to have your sins forgiven and be under the blood of Jesus and be a right standing with God. You don't have to be perfect. You have to be a right standing with God.
Amen.
Do you know the difference? God looks on the hearts of men. You have to want to be perfect.
Amen.
Whether you are or not, you have to want to be perfect.
Yes.
You don't have to be perfect.
Amen.
You have to want to please him.
Praise God.
You don't always have to please him. He knows our frame.
Yeah.
If you read Psalm 103, it says he knows that we are but dust. That's why he's merciful and slow to anger. And he doesn't stay angry at us forever. Oh, he says, as the Father pities his children, so the Father, he pities us.
Lord Jesus. Hallelujah.
And then he showed once and for all he had been pleased with Moses by allowing him to appear to the disciples on the Mount of Transfiguration. And you have to come to the Promised Land. You know that brought comfort to me the first time I went to Israel? It was 2004. My father had just passed. I was on a trip with my mother and my brother and 53 other pastors. 45 of them. It was their very first trip to Israel. My father had single-handedly invited every one of them and convinced them all to come. And then he passes away on August 29th, and the trip wasn't until November. And I was so sad. And we got off at our first stop at Caesarea, not Philippi, but Caesarea by the ocean. And I was just so sad. And one of the evangelists who was on the trip, he sensed my sadness, and he moved in a prophetic, and he walked over to me, and he said, hey, Pastor Tim, did Moses ever get to come to the Holy Land? And I said, no, God didn't let him come. He says, oh, yes, he did, and
Mark chapter 9. He appeared on the Mount of Transfiguration with Jesus. He got the best view. Hallelujah. He got God's view. Hallelujah. He got the better thing. Amen. He says, your dad got a better view. He's with the Lord. He's with the cloud of witnesses.
Amen. Hallelujah.
God's ways are better than our ways. Amen. Amen. And then we look at David. King David takes Uriah's wife, Bathsheba. She becomes pregnant while Uriah's off to war. So he sends for Uriah, hoping he'll go into his wife when he comes off the battlefield, and he will cover up the sin of David. But what happens? Uriah, being a godly man, lays at the feet of his king and says, I will not go and take pleasure with my wife when my brothers are out fighting for you, O king. I'll lay here and pray for you, and I'll pray for my brothers. He could not convince Uriah to even go have pleasure with his wife. So he did the only thing he knew how to do to cover up his sin, because he was supposed to be like unto the high priest of Israel. And he sends away Uriah with his own death sentence. He tells him to give it to the general. And when he gets back, the letter that he gives to the general says, put Uriah in the hottest part of the battle. And when he's up front, pull away and let him get slain.
Yes. All right now.
King David did that?
Yep.
Wow.
Hallelujah.
So what happens? Samuel the prophet comes with a parable. And he tells him about a man that had one little sheep, and he loved that sheep, and he cared for that sheep, and he took care of that little sheep like it was such a prized possession. And there was another man that had a whole flock of sheep. And what did he do? He took that man that had the one little sheep, and he killed him so he could take his sheep. And King David was outraged, and he stood up and he said, who is that man? Bring him to me so I can punish him. And the prophet says, you are that man.
All right now.
Right.
God sees all.
Yes,
you took the wife of Uriah.
Yes, amen.
And she is now with child, and it's your child. David repented. He repented.
Praise God.
He lamented. But God said, now that child will die and shall not live. A man after God's own heart. God is faithful to forgive us of our sins. In Matthew 18, 21, 22, then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me, and shall I forgive him? Till seven times? Jesus said unto him, I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven in one day. We're not supposed to keep a record. Okay, I've forgiven you now. 489, 490, I don't have to do it anymore. No, in one day. Basically, it was like saying an infinite number of times. God's much more merciful than you or I are. How much more do you think he will forgive you? He tells us to forgive each other 7 times 70 in one day. He'll forgive you 7 times 70 in one day. Don't give up. No matter how many times you fall, get up, repent, plead the blood of Jesus, ask for the Holy Spirit to conform you into the image of Christ, and guess what? God is faithful. Keep trying to please him. You know, Romans says, should we sin that grace be available? God forbid. We don't sin on purpose knowing that we can get away thinking God's going to forgive us, because at some point, and we have that attitude, the scripture tells us, that he who is often corrected, yet stiffens his neck and continues in sin, basically.
All right.
Will be cut off suddenly without remedy.
Hallelujah.
We don't know when God's mercy is going to run out.
Amen.
That time I died and I was headed to hell, there is no way that I would have known God was going to be merciful to me until I heard Jesus scream, say, those that call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And I said, Jesus! And I was back in my body after being dead for 24 minutes.
Hallelujah.
He didn't have to do that.
Amen.
He could have let me go to hell.
Amen.
But he did it because he loved me. You don't know in God's ways.
Amen.
What he's going to do. And when his mercy is going to run out. So we serve him
And with the, in 1 John it says that we shouldn't continue in sin. If we just keep sinning like there is no God, then we're not really His. But if we're trying not to sin, remember that what I said, you just have to want to be perfect, right? If we're trying to please Him, if we're putting the Word, if we're spending time in prayer, if we're spending time in relationship, it's not about do's and don'ts, it's about a relationship with a loving God who loves us. He loves us in our sinful state, and He came and died for us. If we want to be perfect, even when we can't, then it says, if you sin, you have an advocate, Christ Jesus, who's at the right hand of the Father, making intercession. You know what? You can fool me, but you can't fool God. I can fool you, but I can't fool God. He knows every single thing I think. The devil doesn't know everything you think. He can just try to manipulate things and stumble, cause you to think he does, but he doesn't. Only God knows the hearts and thoughts of man.
Praise God, praise God.
Be true to yourself.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
After God rejects kings, Alfred, he told King, if you do well, thou shalt be accepted, or shalt thou not be accepted. And if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door. He warned him. If you don't do what's right, you're going to fall into worse sin. And unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him. When we do wrong, we need to call upon God. We need to call upon the blood of Jesus. He will forgive us. In Revelation 2, he tells the church to return to their first love. He says, repent and repeat your first works. That's all we have to do. And God is more merciful than man, and He instructs us to forgive 7 times 70 in one day. Amen. He is just and faithful to forgive us. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus is the best thing I've ever done. You feel that way?
Yes.
Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus, it's the best thing I've ever done. If you're in love with Jesus, you're going to want to please Him. Just like you're in love with our Heavenly Father, you're going to want to please Him. You want to allow the Holy Spirit to move and work in your life. I'm not going to have an altar call. We've had an opportunity to pray. But I'm going to encourage you today. No matter where you are in your walk and your relationship with the God, whether you're just starting it or whether you've been serving Him for many years, some of you, your relationship may have grown cold. Just remember, what He wants is to be in relationship with you. And when we sin, we break that relationship. So we need to hide. We run off and hide like Adam and Eve in the garden. We hide behind the bushes. He doesn't want us to hide. He comes looking for us. And He says, where are you? Where are you? I want to dine with you. Like Matt preached a few weeks ago. I go, and lay down your own desires and tend to His. And he wants to dine with you. He wants to fellowship with you. He wants to be with you. And five children. And you know what? I love to talk to Him.
Yes, amen.
To see Him.
Yes.
I mean, if it just takes a few minutes and share something with me, it makes me so happy. I know they're young, they have their lives, they're not interested in all the old people's stuff like me.
Best time in my life.
But when they share with me, just a few minutes,
I'm enriched, and I feel their love, and they feel mine, and we're both better off for it. That's how God is. Only infinitely more in his love towards you than we have towards our natural children. He loves you so much, and that's why he came and he made a way. As soon as mankind sinned, he came up with a plan to come and rescue us, and he did that very thing. Let us pray. Father, we just come to you in the name of Jesus. We invite your Holy Spirit to work on the hearts of every man, woman, boy, and girl that's in this place today. We ask that you would just move upon our hearts so that you would cause us to want to have a deeper relationship with you, Lord. If we don't know you, Father, Lord, I ask for the Holy Spirit to draw those in that don't know you. We know that one plants the seed and another waters, but only you, O God, through your Holy Spirit, brings the increase. You draw. And we also know, Lord, that only you can cause us to walk in your righteousness and to be hid within you. It's your Holy Spirit dwelling in us that conforms us to your image. Conform us to your image, Lord. Lord, I make many mistakes. Lord, let me walk in love, Lord. Don't let me appear angry, Lord. Let me be a light in the darkness. Let me be a witness to those that even disagree with me, Lord. Let them feel your love for them, the same love that caused you to leave glory and come to earth. Let them feel that when they look at me. And not only me, Father, but each member of this congregation, each member of the body of Christ that is represented here today. Lord, let us be your lights. Let us be like that city on a hill that's lifted up, that will draw all men unto you, not to us, but to you. Let our works be pleasing to you. Let us commune with you so that when we meet you face to face, you'll say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter in, for great is your reward. Thank you, Jesus. We give you all the praise and glory. In your name we pray. Amen. Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. That we should be called the sons of God. That we should be called the sons of God. And we are.